The Social Media Examiner production. I'm Mike Stelzner. My co-host today is Eric Fisher, the head of social for Social Media Examiner. Kim Reynolds is in the control room. Jeff C. is handling simulcast. This is the show for you, the marketer, the entrepreneur, the somebody who needs to stay on the leading edge of social media and wants to know what happened just in the last week so that you can get that little competitive edge and lead in your industry. It's brought to you by our brand new sponsor. We're super excited. Social Media Marketing World 2018. Can I hear a woohoo? Anybody here going to the conference? If you are, please say I'm going in the comment section. We literally just opened the doors to Social Media Marketing World 2018. And as of today, Friday, June 16th, this is the best price that you can get to come back to the conference or to go to the conference for the first time. We've got a brand new creator ticket, which is half the price of the regular ticket and just gets you access to just creator content. Check it out. We're expecting 5,000 to 6,000 people. It's going to be awesome. All right. On today's show, we're going to explore, first of all, some brand new stuff from Snapchat for marketers. And Carlos Gill will be joining us in seconds. In the second segment, Facebook video cover photos, or whatever they're calling. What are they calling these things? Video covers.
Video covers.
Facebook page video covers. How you can put video into your Facebook page with Jeff C. In the third segment, all sorts of changes coming from Twitter and lots of other breaking news. Couple housekeeping things. Get us on your calendar, socialmediaexaminer.com/live show. Number two, share this, please, on whatever platform you're on. Let the world know about it. Number three, if you got to bail early on this broadcast, on Saturday at socialmediaexaminer.com, we have a very detailed breakdown of everything that we're talking about. So check it out. All right. With that, we're going to go ahead and bring on Carlos Gill, and I'm going to go ahead and bring up the screen sharing as well. Carlos, how you doing, my man?
What's going on, guys? Greetings from Jacksonville, Florida, where it's a little wet right now, but I am
trying to stay. Oh, wow. It was just sunny a minute ago, huh? It's crazy how that stuff works. So Carlos is one of the top experts in the world on Snapchat and also, of course, knows a lot about generating stories with video. And Carlos, I know there's been a lot of news going on literally in the last couple of days with Snapchat, specifically tools to allow marketers, and not just creators, but marketers to tap into the Snapchat platform. Can you kind of break it down for us and tell us what the news is?
Yeah, absolutely. So the news is that Snapchat has expanded their ad product suite. They've also introduced a self-service option. This is something, guys, that is monumental for Snapchat, because for the longest time, you've had marketers that have been on the fence about using Snapchat because it didn't have the functionality that Facebook and Twitter offer with ad products. So the ad products that they offer, I'm going to just go ahead and run those off real quickly. You've got Snap Ads, which are promotable 10-second vertical ads. You've got Snap Articles, which are text-based articles that you can promote within Snapchat. You have app installs, so you can promote your mobile app. And then you have long-form video beyond the 10 seconds. And then you also have web view ads, which take clips from your website and incorporate them into Snaps.
So, Carlos, tell me, is this prior to this self-service thing, and I don't know exactly what it's called, but prior to making it easy for people to self-service, you had to use, it looks like it's Ad Manager. You had to go through an agency, right? So what makes this so much better and so much easier and maybe so much accessible, especially for smaller businesses?
So what's great about it is that just like with geofilters, there is no ad minimum that small businesses have to spend. So I just want to go ahead and repeat that. There is no ad minimum. You can spend as little as $10 or $100 or go upward from there. You can also manage your own ads. Here's what really stands out with the new self-service option is you can upload your YouTube video content. You can upload pre-roll content and it will go ahead and create it in vertical video for you. So there's no special editing that has to be done. There's nothing different that has to be created. You can literally take your YouTube video content and put it right into this new Ads Manager tool.
Eric, let's go ahead and click on that image there, which I think should bring up a bigger version of it, that green one in the middle of the screen there, and maybe we can kind of dissect what's going on here. If it's not working, maybe just plus it up so we can kind of maybe see a little bit more of what's going on here. Eric, you can see better than I can see. Tell us kind of what you see here, and then maybe Carlos, you can comment on this.
Yeah, so we're seeing obviously a spend here and impressions. ECPM. swipe ups and cost per swipe up.
So Carlos, what is an ECPM in your opinion, and a swipe up? A swipe up, I think I know what it means, but maybe you could describe it a little bit.
So the swipe up is very similar to what we've seen now with the swipe up feature in Instagram. For the longest time, you've had marketers that have complained that with Snapchat, there's no way to click out of Snapchat and go back to a website. So with this new ad product, they've now integrated the same functionality that you see on Instagram. So you can essentially drive people from the ad in Snapchat back to your website. So that's the cost per swipe up, you know, and the number of swipe ups is great because now marketers actually measure the ROI of what they're spending with their Snapchat ads. I also want to
go ahead.
Now, I was also going to add something that kind of went under the radar, and that is Snapchat audiences. So once again, I've heard from marketers over the last couple of years, you know, Snapchat's great for storytelling, engaging millennials. I get it, but there's no way to do ad targeting. Well, guess what? Now Snapchat offers about 60 different interest-based categories that you can target people based on. You can target people based on age and gender, based on language, based on location. So not only have they expanded their suite of ad products beyond geofilters, but you can also now target specific audiences.
Very cool. Editorial team, we definitely want to make sure we get an article written about how to use this ads manager feature. Carlos, for those of us that are not on Snapchat, and let's be honest, that's a lot of us, where do these ads show up? Can you kind of explain that?
Yeah, great question. So these ads show up in between your friends' stories on Snapchat. So what's pretty cool is as you're watching your own friends' stories, I'd say probably between every 4 to 5, you'll see an ad inserted in between one story to another.
And how long are these ads typically?
So these ads can range anywhere from 10 seconds all the way on upward to 30.
And are they? Can they be still images or video?
Aha. Most of them are video. However, they with this new ad product, you can use still images, and then it'll actually animate the image for you.
Do you have any experience with this? I mean, I don't know if you've done this for your employer, or have you messed around inside of this? I mean, is this that new that maybe you don't have any experience, or have you tried it out yet?
So right now you actually have to request access through Snapchat to go ahead and be able to access the suite. I personally haven't done so yet.
Got it.
BNC. But it's something that they're indicating from what I've read that's going to be rolled out throughout June and July on a self-serve basis without having to sign up.
Now, Eric, was there another screenshot in this article that we could scroll down to? I'm pretty sure there was, if we keep scrolling down a little bit further. Yeah, Snap Publisher. Talk to us about what this thing is, and let's go ahead and plus that image up a little bit, and maybe you can describe what we're looking at here, Carlos.
So what we're looking at here is how you actually build your ads. So I think last time I was on the show a couple weeks ago, we talked about the publisher for geofilters. This is very similar to that. You can upload your own video content. You can upload your own photo content. And then there's different templates in there where you can drop in your logo. You can go ahead and drop in a call to action. So from my perspective, it's actually much more intuitive than even Facebook Ads Manager, because this actually helps you build your ads. So you don't have to necessarily rely on an agency or even outsource it. You can do this all yourself.
So it looks like from what we're seeing here is this could be a still image or a video, and then a logo. Literally, there's just an object where you can plop your logo in there and it's just going to build out the ad. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Now, is this also something that's literally brand new? Have you had a chance to mess with this at all?
This is brand new. So this literally just rolled out. And once again, I wanted to go ahead and clarify that if you upload a video, let's say you have a video that's not sized vertically. Let's say it's a pre-roll video that's sized horizontally. Snapchat will go ahead and resize it for you. It'll go ahead and cut it off, so it might be cropped on the sides. But it'll go ahead and at least reformat the video specific for Snapchat size specifications for you.
Eric, didn't we have some tool that we talked about on my podcast that allows you to create vertical videos really easily? Do you remember what that is off the top of your head?
Storio was one.
Storio. And how do you spell that?
Storio.
Cool. So I like the fact that they're making this kind of simple and brainless. And Carlos, you said they also have templates. Is that correct?
Yeah, so they have templates. So from what I saw in the same TechCrunch article as you, there's different templates. You can see it right there where it says brand logo. It's drag and drop. You can just drop your company logo in there. And one thing I want to point out, I know there's a lot of small to medium businesses in the Social Media Examiner community. This is a completely free tool for you to use. And once again, there's no ad spend minimum.
Oh, so wait a minute. So Let me ask you this question. Can we use this tool to create updates on Snapchat and ads, or is it just for ads?
You can use this to create ads.
Okay. And I would imagine, can you download the final product, or does it kind of live? I mean, I guess, well, you probably have you messed with this yet? No, you haven't messed with this.
I have not messed with it though.
Yeah. I mean, like, that's the thing. Like, some of this stuff, folks, is so new. So Eric, let's go to the other screenshot in the article, because I want to talk about the Snapchat certified partners. Do you know what this is? Can you, well, it's not really a screenshot, I guess, but what is this Snapchat certified partner? What does it mean? Did we lose Carlos?
I'm here, Mike. Sorry.
Yeah, the Snapchat certified partners, what is that, Carlos?
Yeah, so what Snapchat certified partners is that you can either buy the ads yourself and build them yourself, or you can work with one of their partners. So I'll give you an example. You know, I work with Sprinklr, right? And they have an API to run Facebook ads and Twitter and LinkedIn ad campaigns. So now they're opening up their API. So these other companies, these other vendors that historically have done things like Google advertising for display, you know, or Facebook ads, now those vendors will be able to go ahead and run Snapchat ads for you.
Awesome. Carlos, what else do you want to tell us specifically about either this announcement or Snapchat in general? Because I know there's been a couple other things that have been in the news recently about Snapchat.
Yeah, I want to say Snapchat recently acquired a company in order to go ahead and open up geolocation advertising. So once again, I know there's a lot of small businesses in the Social Media Examiner community. Don't sleep on Snapchat. I'm really surprised by the survey results of the 7%. This is a platform that now has over 160 million active users. It's continuing to grow. It's continuing to make it more accessible for advertisers to get in front of those millennials. So if, like I often say, if your company is selling to 13 to 35 year olds, you absolutely should be on Snapchat. If you're looking for alternatives to Instagram or Facebook, from an advertising standpoint, you should definitely look into Snapchat's new ad products.
One last thing I wanted to go back to. In the very beginning, you said that there were different kinds of actions that we can do on a Snapchat ad, if I'm not mistaken. Can you reiterate what they are again, just so us as marketers can think this through? One of them obviously was a swipe up, which means that they can go off to your website. But wasn't there some other actions that you mentioned or types of ads?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to go ahead and break it down. So one is a snap ad, which is just a 10-second snap. The other is an article. So if you're familiar with Facebook Instant Articles, it's very similar to where you can see a video snap, and then you can swipe up and you can also read an article. You also have App and Snap. So if you want to promote your mobile app to the Snapchat community, you can go ahead and do that. Someone can swipe up and they can download your app. And there's also long form video, which I've seen larger, more enterprise brands do this, where it's 30-second ads broken up into three different snaps. And then you also have what's known as a web view, which is taking your website and incorporating it into a snap.
Do you know if all of these different products are going to be available in the self-service platform?
They will all be available.
Wow. So let me ask a question then. For the snap, the article one, do people actually read articles on Snapchat? Does that work? And talk to us about some possible applications there.
Here's the thing. Snapchat, from my perspective, is replacing the TV, at least for millennials and Generation Z. And when you look at the Discover section of Snapchat and you see Fox and CNN and ESPN there, they're essentially taking 30 minutes worth of programming on TV and chopping it down to 2 to 3 minutes on Snapchat. Same thing with articles. So Cosmopolitan, you know, very large brands are taking their longer form blog content, and they're putting it into more of a micro condensed form in Snapchat. What's really cool about these ads is that you're gonna be able to see a 10-second snap and then swipe up and read a little bit more context, as opposed to just seeing a 10-second video.
Oh, I see. So the idea is that when I'm on Snapchat and I'm going between my friends, I will see an ad, and that ad generally is a video, and the swipe up could be an article, or it could be a link off to the website. Is that, or it could be an install of an app. Is that kind of what I hear you saying?
Correct. So you'll be able to either swipe up and read an article. So let's say Social Media Examiner wants to go ahead and do a snap to promote a new blog post or a new article.
Or the conference.
Or the conference, for that fact of the matter. Imagine you can take conference speakers to do takeovers or you can create video content with those conference speakers and then have a link that swipes up and goes directly to the registration page.
Interesting. So, but if we wanted to have it be an article, does the article also allow links? Do you follow where I'm going? Like, because one of the things we learned about certain social networks is sometimes people don't want to leave the network. So hypothetically, could we have a little video and then swipe up and have kind of a sales letter, if you will, for the conference and then have a click to register to just go right to the register page? Is that something you think could happen with an article?
There's no indication from what I've read that that would be possible.
I see.
Quite frankly, but what I would recommend is you A/B test where you have ads that have just an article, and then you also have ads that have the swipe up linking back to the website, and you also have a website ad. So you can essentially take the social media marketing world website and turn that into a ad within Snapchat. Mm.
Well, folks, I just want to give you some of my raw commentary here. While I do believe that Snapchat has not innovated as fast as I would have liked, I would have expected a lot of this to come out during the IPO. I think finally there are tools for the everyday marketer here. And if some of your audience is on Snapchat, then you kind of owe it to yourself to mess around with this because there's not a lot of competition right now. And on Facebook, there's a lot of competition. So you might be able to actually get a lot lower cost per acquisition, a lot lower cost per click, cost per impression, whatever the metric is that you care about on Snapchat, if your audience that you're trying to target is actively on Snapchat. For that reason, I asked our editorial team to go ahead and work up an article. For that reason, I want to encourage you to not overlook this because, you know, while we might not, people our age may not, or my age may not want to be creating content on Snapchat, it doesn't mean that there's not a viable audience there for us to go ahead and try to get in front of as marketers. Carlos, why don't you can give us your closing thoughts and where people can discover more about you and all the cool stuff you got going on.
Yeah, so real quick on closing thoughts, one thing that I want to point out is that what's great about Snapchat is you don't have to have an account on there and create content to still have the presence on Snapchat. You can run geo filters, which are, you know, cost effective and still an efficient way to reach Snapchat users within a certain radius. And I just want to point out that radius doesn't have to be your place of business. It can be anywhere. Or you can go ahead and now use these new ad products and still have a presence on Snapchat without having to create content.
Awesome. Where can people discover you, Carlos?
Yeah, add me on Snapchat, @CarlosGill, and you can also visit my website, carlosgill.biz.
All right, buddy. Talk to you later. Have a great one, okay?
Take care. See you.
All right, folks, we're going to go ahead and get our next person, which I think is Jeff. Is that right, Eric? Yep. We're going to get Jeff C. on here to talk about something exciting from Facebook. And while we're doing that, I just want to remind you guys that this show is brought to you by our sponsor. And surprise, surprise, our sponsor is Social Media Marketing World. And it's the conference you do not want to miss. And some of you are like, wait a minute, isn't that 9 months from now? And yes, it's 9 months from now, but guess what? Already almost 700 people have purchased their tickets to the conference. That's how big of a deal this is. And if you are financially constrained and you've always wanted to go, this is your chance to save a significant amount of money. It's currently $700 off. It's a big deal. Visit smmw18.com. That stands for Social Media Marketing World. smmw18.com. With that, Jeff, welcome to the show, my man. How you doing?
Doing well, doing well. Thanks for having me on again.
So why don't you tell everybody what the news is, and we're going to go ahead and bring up this screenshot here. So what's going on? What's the news this week?
So we broke this a couple of weeks ago that they were testing these Facebook video covers. And what the deal is they tested it first on the Facebook page, on the Netflix page, Narcos. And we thought we had it, but we really didn't. So it is rolling out now. I have it. Other people have had it. Some people got it as late as last week. So you can now upload videos to your cover photo. So right here, it shows you on the Social Media Examiner. When you'll see this blue, if you go to your Facebook business page and you have this blue kind of notification, that lets you know that you are able to do this. And so it gives you kind of the rundown right there. You can upload a video that is 20 to 90 seconds, and it should be at least 820 by 312. Now, when I originally started messing with this back when I first thought I had it, I thought, well, I got to crop a video to this dimension. What Eric and I have learned while we've been testing this it's probably not a good idea to crop your video. It's probably better to upload a high quality video because it doesn't crop it on the mobile application. So your full video will play. So that's kind of the breakdown. And I'm still getting echo too. Sorry guys, I don't know what's going on with Crowdcast, but it plays really the one that I uploaded was 1920 by 1080 and it was a MP4 file and it was only about 30 megabytes as size. So it works really well. It works awesome on the mobile device. When you do upload this video for the first time, it will upload it and it'll give you options, 10 different options, kind of like when you upload a photo normally, a video normally on your Facebook page, it will give you a thumbnail options. So you want to make sure that you get a good image that will work well when people first land on your page. And so right
hey,
here,
Jeff, this, any sense yeah. on where are they just randomly capturing these thumbnails? Because this is obviously part of the challenge is that these thumbnails might not look good, right?
They are randomly capturing it, and there's no way as of yet to upload your own thumbnail.
Oh,
so, yeah, so it's kind of a bummer. Now, there were some people who reported that it didn't autoplay on mobile. It did for me. So, and it did it kind of randomly. And what I think is the reason why is you want to have a video file that is optimized for mobile, which means the smallest file sizes you can, because I think that's why some people were reporting that it wasn't autoplaying is because it was actually loading on the mobile app. It did do it for me. Here's a screenshot where you can see the full version of the video that is playing. So
now that's a pretty high resolution video too.
Yeah, it looks great on mobile and that's a Retina screen and it looked really, really nice. So my advice would be not to stress too much about the desktop image because most people are actually going to stuff on your mobile device. So I would put those videos up there. When you do upload them, you are able to, just like a normal cover photo is, you know, adjust kind of where it falls on the page. You can drag it up or down to kind of center it the best. And so I would do that on your videos. I'd make sure your call to actions, if you have any, or like a logo bug or something like that on your video, wasn't down in the corner. I'd make sure that it was, you know, visible kind of in the center. And luckily enough, my little video here was able to be centered like that. And I think Eric's got a screenshot kind of that shows kind of the cutoff of what will look like on a mobile device. So the other cool thing is here it is right here. That's kind of the lines. This is very, very rough.
Okay, but now this is important. I just looked up your page and it is not autoplaying for me. So just so everybody knows, I can show you what it looks like because I think this is useful for everyone to kind of see what this looks like. I'm going to go ahead and pull back to camera mode. This is what I see. I don't know. Oops, my camera just went dark. This is what I see when I'm on the page. I see a big play button in the middle of the screen, Jeff. I think the reason it's autoplaying for you is because you own the page and it's showing you what it's going to look like.
It actually autoplayed for me too.
It's very random. Okay. And I actually went and logged off of my account and logged on another person's account to make sure. And it does autoplay. And
look what happens when I hit play. In my case, it actually takes over the entire screen.
And if you switch it sideways, it does go full screen in the window. So
yeah,
it does go
full. It is kind of interesting and wonky, like how it works, right? Now that I've hit play, it's almost like it's preloaded the darn thing and now it's playing automatically, which is just things I think we need to keep in mind when we are doing this kind of stuff.
Something else that I noticed on mobile is the fact that, you know how the avatar and the title of the page used to be up on that cover image, they're now down below. So that whole shadow thing we were dealing with having to have a separate image and kind of cropping it differently so that it played well with mobile, seems like it's not becoming an issue anymore.
And there's a couple of cool things also is that when you do post it, for me, and I double checked that everybody could see it on the other account as well, it does put a post on your page that Jeff C. has uploaded a new cover video. And you can also go into your video library and check the stats on that cover photo. So it's actually going to pull stats for you and let you see those. So if you have a video and you're like, well, is it working or not? Are people watching it? You can go and see. So like this one I did yesterday, I already had 106 views or whatever on it, so I know it's working. You can also use Cinemagraphs, and this is a great way, I think, because it automatically loops. And this is on Flixel's site. I think, yeah, I pronounced
what
it
right. What the heck is a Cinemagraph for those of us that don't know what that is?
It's like an animated GIF that things play in the background, but there's parts of the image that is still, and they're really eye-catching. And so I would think this would be one of the ways to kind of set yourself apart. So go to Flixels. They have a great Cinemagraph tool. But if you see the stuff in the background is moving, but the people on the front of the video aren't, and the dollar bill's kind of waving. So it's really eye-catching. It's very, so very
is
cool.
Is this actually a video that's just been built yes. to look like yes. it's an animated GIF? Is that the idea?
Uh-huh, exactly.
Now, one of the things that I like about this example is I like how they put their brand in the video still, and mm-hmm. it's fixed there, you know? I think that would be a best practice for a lot of us, right? Because presumably, you know, I mean, obviously Facebook doesn't add all that cool stuff inside of there, and I do like that quite a bit. Another thing that I think is very important for people to understand is the pixel height is totally different for desktop than it is for mobile. And you may have mentioned that, but I want to refocus on that. It's 820 by 312 pixels for desktop, but it's 820 by 462 pixels for the mobile. So the mobile, Eric, if you can go back to your screenshot on the mobile, people can kind of understand when they see it, they'll notice the depth of the image it's taller. Do you have that, or did you already close it? Yeah, there you go. So it's a much taller image where it's cut off on the desktop. So I think we want to reiterate what Jeff talked about. I think, didn't you have a screenshot with some red lines on it there? Mm-hmm. That's, you know, when you design this video, you kind of need to understand that. Jeff, maybe you can talk about what you created here. Is this like a little template for yourself, so you kind of knew what
the- I wanted to show people what the, you can use a full-size video, which is what I did, is I uploaded the 1920 by 1080, and I moved the center so that little badge is centered for the desktop version. But since the mobile version plays it, and those dimensions you gave are actually 16 by 9 reduced down to, you know, the 820, what did I say, 820, I can't remember the thing, the 820, yeah, the 820 thing. That's just scaling down a 16 by 9 video. So you really don't have, you just got to make sure your video that you upload for desktop will work in those constrained spaces. On mobile, it should be fine.
Got it. So what I hear you saying is mobile, good old 16 by 9, any size, as long as it's at least 820 pixels wide, should work if it's 16 by 9 format. Is that correct?
Right. Yes.
So that means you could put, high definition video up there if you really wanted to, like 720p or 1080p or whatever, right?
Exactly.
But if you get too large, then it could create a problem on mobile, is what I hear you saying.
Yeah, I would.
Have you noticed any rasterization?
I have not.
Okay. Because sometimes, you know how when you upload videos to Facebook, they like process the videos and then make them look a little different?
Yeah. Yeah, I haven't seen any that way. I would try to optimize it. I think maybe some of the delay where people are seeing if it's auto-loading or not is because they're uploading a really big file size and Facebook can play it, but on mobile it takes a little bit longer to, you know, start the render and start the playback.
Duration recommendations.
It can only be 20 to 90 seconds. I would keep it as short as possible and loop it. Make this one that I use, for example, really doesn't make sense to loop. I mean, it's not seamless, but the one that Narcos was doing was actually like money falling on the table, and that just kind of continued loop. So if you have a loop or something, like you have some looping video that has your logo on it or some, you know, some text, make it loop seamlessly, I think would be the best option for people.
When you do click in on the video, it does actually become a regular video on mobile, but if you don't click on it and it auto plays, then it's just a regular video. Eric, what's your thoughts on this? I mean, like, should we actually put text around the video in case someone does click in on it and kind of maybe link to something? I don't know. What do you or Jeff, either one of you guys have a thought on that?
There are no captions, so that's something to take in consideration as well.
Oh, but I'm talking about like when you upload a video, don't you normally get the option to put text descriptions. Oh, I'm saying, oh, it doesn't even have, I see. So you,
yeah. Well, yeah.
Can you take an existing video though? You can take an existing video is my understanding and make it a cover. Is that correct?
Yes.
You mean your existing, library, yes. Yeah. From your Facebook library.
Yeah. Cause here's what I'm thinking. What if you took an existing video from your Facebook library that already has all the captions and the text around it and stuff and made that your cover photo. And if someone did click on it, then hypothetically they would see all that text, right? I'm just thinking out of the box here. You understand what I'm saying, Jeff? So like if you had uploaded this image directly to your video library and you had chosen to put text around the image so that if somebody clicked on the image, they would see some text below it, just like they would with any other image. I wonder whether that would carry over into the cover. That's what I'm saying. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I did not test that, so I'm not sure if that would work or not. I think especially because it's on mobile and sound doesn't autoplay. If you want them to watch it, you need to make sure that you have some sort of text or even doing, I don't know, subtitles. You could test that. One of the things that I would be careful of is don't just throw video on to throw video on, because it's hard enough to get people to come to your Facebook page. And if you have a video up there that looks bad, that's really something you don't want to do, especially since they've taken the time to come visit you. You want to make sure it's really, really high quality and really professional.
Yeah, one of the things that we're probably going to do is take our existing Facebook cover photograph and just animate little portions of it, so it's subtly animated, which I think would make it look really killer. You know what I mean? Like, just imagine like that one you showed us, Jeff, where you could see just some stuff was still and some stuff wasn't. I think it'd be really cool to just take a still image and just move subtly little pieces of it, and it might make it really stand out. Who knows? Anyways, cool thing, cool stuff, Jeff. Thank you so much for sharing this. Why don't you tell everybody where they can discover more about you?
Yeah, the best place that they can find me is at manlypinteresttips.com, where we're always adding testosterone one pin at a time.
Thank you, Jeff. All right, folks, as you can see, exciting news this week. I know a lot of you are going to want to start messing around with video. So go ahead, give it a shot and let us know how it's working for you. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of creative applications and maybe even tools that are going to make creating these kinds of videos really, really awesome. Last thing I want to mention is Social Media Marketing World is the sponsor of this show. Check it out, smmw18.com. Over to you, Eric.
All right. So we've got some cool new updates that came out as of yesterday or the day before. I can't remember which, but I think most people noticed it yesterday. Twitter has come out with a really big, well, biggest, it's negotiable, but a pretty decent sized UI update across its mobile apps as well as the Twitter.com interface. And they have this, basically they come out with a new streamlined look that gives you the ability to open links and from different websites within the platform. The majority of the overhaul, I have to say, is in the iOS app, and it's actually made to look a little bit more like TweetDeck, or not TweetDeck, Twitter for Android, which had a little bit of this already, but is now fully formed over as well to coincide. So one of the things that I can show you here, there's this GIF that's playing, and this is the mobile version. You can see that there's only now four tabs or icons and tabs down at the bottom. So the first one is home, and it looks like a home and also a birdhouse. That's Twitter. The next one over is the magnifying glass, which is the search bar or the searching Twitter for functionality. The next one over is the bell, which is for notifications. And then the mail, the envelope, the mail icon is for the direct messages. And then you're wondering, well, how do I get to my profile? Well, you tap up in the upper left corner, as they just did. You tap up there on your icon of your face, and that's where you have the ability to switch accounts, as well as see your profile, your lists, and as well as moments. So they've kind of hidden moments on the mobile here, which is a little bit curious because that's one of the main things they've been working on for a while now. So,
Eric, do we have desktop screenshots or no?
The desktop is literally the same thing. It's literally, they didn't rearrange anything other than changing the I can give you an example here. Here's the icons. They changed the back. You see on the retweet here, it was a version of that curved arrow that used to be the reply. They've now changed that into a bubble, a chat bubble. They wanted to make that look a little bit more clean and crisp and rounded and fresh for them. Some of the other changes that they've made, again, desktop has this as well as mobile, which is they've bolded some of the highlights, or sorry, they've bolded some of the headlines.
Can you pull up your Twitter profile real quick? Because when we were in pre-show yesterday, there were some things that we talked about that looked a little different, and maybe it was just me, but
it wasn't any, they didn't rearrange anything. It's literally just the circle profile thing here. The instead of the rounded kind of the rounded edge off of a square for an avatar, it's now a circle, and these new icons and the typography is a little bit different.
One of the things, obviously, folks, if you have not checked out your Twitter avatar to make sure it looks good in a circle, you might want to, because you know they are cropping off the corners. And if you had something in your avatar, like part of your brand, that is being cropped off because it's now in a circle, you might need to rethink the design of your avatar. And that is something definitely to keep in mind, because, like, for example, in our case, it still looks fine, I think, when you go to our, our account, but it may not for every brand. It just depends how you were leveraging that real estate. Like, if you had some words in your avatar, those words are probably going to get cropped depending on where they were. So just some feedback there. What else we got on Twitter?
All right. So what else that we have on Twitter? And again, I want to echo, there's no functionality change when it comes to this interface change. It's all eye candy changes. It's a UI change up. Everything that used to be there in terms of functionality is still there.
Cool.
Next up, so Twitter has been working hard on getting their act, you know, even more together than before when it comes to customer service. And they like to work with customer service, especially in the terms of direct messages. And what they are doing now is they are attaching smart action buttons to Twitter messages that'll make it easy for people to click on those buttons and take them into a direct message conversation, and they can click those and it'll help compose a tweet, a suggested tweet, almost like a click to tweet within direct messages, which is pretty cool, because then you can pre-populate the things that you want shared from your, so we can have an account or a poll from our account and saying, I am going to social media marketing world, or I'm getting my tickets today, or something like that. You know, we can have different click to tweet options set up in those buttons that are easy to click on and share. And they're more likely to share because they're right there in Twitter in and of itself, which is pretty cool. One of the examples that they gave is the fact that with this movie, you can, for example, they're giving the score here, tweet your score, you can take a quiz, watch the trailer, or buy tickets. This person opted to click take the quiz, and so they took the quiz inside of direct messages. It was an interactive experience, and then once they got a 4 out of 5, they had the option then to click to tweet their score, or even follow a certain account, not necessarily the account that is Focus Features, but the Beguiled, which is the movie that this Focus Features is presenting. So there's a lot of cross-pollinization and interactivity that they've beefed up here in terms of this direct messaging things that they've included here with this update.
Awesome. All right, let's move on to the next news item, Eric, unless you have something else on Twitter. Do you have something else, or is that it?
Yeah, so one more quick thing. Twitter is testing putting in a current events kind of, it's a happening now. You can see here on the left, they've got this here. They're testing it. So this isn't out there. This is something that was seen again by Recode, and they brought it to light here. So you can see happening now. There's some MLB games that are popped up right there at the top. These are tweets. This is almost, it reminds me of Snapchat, you know, where you've got those except these would be vertical video instead of horizontal video. But it's kind of cool. Again, Twitter calls themselves the, you know, how to find out what's happening right now. And this is them moving more towards that direction. And this is on mobile. So
awesome. Facebook has rolled out two new ad campaign tools. And Eric, we do have some screenshots sourced from Adweek. And there's two different options. The first option is something called value optimization. And this allows advertisers basically to optimize their campaigns based on purchase value data that is passed by the Facebook pixel from your website over to Facebook over a 7-day period of time. Azriel Ratz, who is a friend of Social Media Examiner and a Facebook expert, said that this is just an optimization within the ad set. So instead of optimizing for conversions, people will be able to optimize for their highest value customers, if you will. And then this is also really useful for people that have lots of products running purchase ads. So instead of ads focusing on any sort of sale, you can focus on getting the sales that will bring you the most revenue. Now, here's what we don't know. We don't totally understand how these purchase values are sent via the Facebook pixel to Facebook. But I think a couple weeks ago, we talked about how Facebook is starting to send more data up to Facebook. So my guess is that Facebook is just monitoring checkout and all that kind of stuff. I don't exactly understand that. And sometimes we don't totally understand these things because it's that new. We also know that this feature, which is again called value optimization, is rolling out to eligible businesses over the next few months. And we believe this is predominantly focused on high volume retailers. The second feature, which I think might be of interest to a lot of people, is something called value-based lookalike audiences. And this allows you to upload, and Eric, maybe you can describe what we're seeing here just because I'm not seeing as big of a screenshot because, what are we looking at here?
So what we're seeing here is you've got these different identifiers for customers that you can select from that range from email, phone number, first and last name, zip code, all the typical bio stuff.
Yeah, and then there's a column, and I can see it now. There's a column where you can increase, you can put in the value of the customer. So in this case, if you've figured out a way to calculate the lifetime value of a customer, you can upload that data. And then the idea here is that this will allow you to create a lookalike audience for a segment of your customer database that is most valuable. And that's pretty much what we know about this right now. So in my own words, I think what this is if you had 10,000 customers and 1,000 of them were, you know, the high value ones, you could essentially segment them into an audience and say, these are my high value customers. Find me other people that are just like them. And this is a new lookalike audience. All right, Eric, over to you about the GIFs.
All right. So
how you say it.
Well, there you go. So there's one of the controversial things that comes up when it comes to GIFs or GIFs. Facebook has rolled out the ability to natively reply on Facebook with GIFs or GIFs.
Why don't you explain where it is, like maybe circle with your mouse over the bottom there.
Yeah. So what we're seeing here in this image and typically on any Facebook post, there's the ability to comment. You can write your comment, and then over on the right, you will see the emojis, the photos, and then now you see a GIF button. And if you tap that GIF button, it brings up the GIF, some of the most popular, the trending GIFs, and then it also allows you to start typing in the GIF search across many different GIF apps. It's not just, I mean, this is pulling from many different GIF depositories or suppositories, whatever you want to call it, repositories. I'm mixing the words, but yeah, there you go.
By the way, on a iOS, it looks, this is, I think, an Android screenshot. It looks a little different. On the iOS, you're going to see the little GIF thing inside of a little gray box. But what's cool about it is like Eric said, it's only in the comments, and it's amazing what you can search for. You can think of anything you could possibly want to search for, and then you could find your favorite one and it inserts it. Now, one thing to keep in mind is it only inserts the GIF. You do not have the ability to add text and a GIF together. So you have to like keep those comments separated. But it's pretty crazy. We've tried this out, Eric, right, on our Facebook page, and people have been going nuts over this thing.
Yeah, crazy. Crazy high engagement. It adds, you know, you've always been able to drop a link in to a GIF and have that then populate there. But the fact that Facebook tapped into that emotional response and made a GIF button in there that's natively baked into the desktop and the mobile devices is pretty awesome for a lot of people. And
I think you can do this on desktop too, can't you?
Yeah.
So what we did, Eric, tell everybody what we did yesterday, and they should try it out on their pages as well.
Yeah, and somebody even commented and said, great engagement strategy, guys. And what we did was we posted, I forget the exact text, but what we said was, do you have the new GIF reply feature? If so, comment here with one. And we had, I don't know, upwards of six to, you know, at least 600 comments, all GIFs.
It's just, yeah,
it was crazy.
It was pretty crazy, and I can't think of the last time we had that many comments. Can you, Eric?
No.
So you can encourage people to reply with a GIF as just a fun way of getting some engagement on your page. So right now, you just know whenever they come out with these features, if you actively do these features, then, of course, you're going to get more exposure because that's how this stuff works with Facebook.
Yeah.
All right.
And by the way, I want to throw out one 2 second thing is just the fact that Twitter's had this for a long time and a lot of people use this for customer service. This is a way that you can spice up your engagement of your page with your fans of your page.
Well, and so, Apple has this on the iMessage, yes. Right? So this is kind of coming finally a little late, if you will, to Facebook, right?
True.
But let me just say that I am a little concerned. It's getting a little MySpacey. What do you think, Eric?
I think it'll blow over. I think, you know, like the whole colored text image thing.
Animated GIFs and videos on the Facebook page top. I mean, I think we're getting into this too much movement kind of, and I think people might just tune out. That's my honest opinion.
I agree.
What do you guys think in the comment sections? Do you think this is going to be something that is going to be really annoying? You know, I don't know. We'll see what happens. All right. Next news item. Facebook is now testing the ability to add star ratings to your ads. Now, this image is courtesy of Adweek. And basically what we're looking at, Eric, what are we looking at here?
Yeah, so inside of settings, what they've done is star rating experiment. They've checked the box to say they want to participate in the experiment that shows your business's star ratings in ads. This is a pretty cool way that if you're running ads, it's going to add an extra amount of social proof to your ads, because if you've got a pretty high star rating, like we do for Social Media Marketing World, then it just lends that much more credibility to your ads.
Yeah, so if you have a page that is a place, right, like a physical business or in our case, Social Media Marketing World, and there's great star ratings, they'll only show the star ratings if they're 4 or above. So it's not going to be like going to hurt you to do this. And I kind of think that just adds a little bit of extra credence to some of your advertisements. So I would, you know, and by the way, not everybody has this. We do not have this yet on our conference page, right, Eric?
No, I don't think so. No, we checked. Yeah, we don't.
Yeah. So this is obviously one of those kind of things that, you know, I don't think is rolled out to everyone yet. So over to you, Eric.
Correct. So Facebook is working on expanding monetization opportunities inside of instant articles. They are now allowing you to testing ad units, I should say, inside the related article section at the bottom of instant articles. This week, they've now added to that this opening the test to all the publishers inside of instant articles. So you can see here in the image from our sponsors, and then there's a clearly defined and monitored or noted sponsored ad here for Jasper's Market here. And this is inside of an instant article. So you could start running these ads from other people inside of your instant articles.
Well, and you know, there's two sides to this. You can make money with your instant articles now by having these ads be under the recommended section. The other side of it is you potentially could insert your ads into other people's instant articles, right? Yeah, so there's two angles at this, one from a monetization side, from a creator perspective/publisher, and the other one from obviously the side is the marketer. Okay, we're going to move into our, we need some special music. Oh, you know what? I've got the music. We need some Found in the Wild music. And I actually have something here somewhere that I'm going to find, but we're going to move into our, oh, here we go. Let's see. How's this? This is our Found in the Wild segment. You guys like the music? I don't know if you can hear it or not, Eric. If you I could hear it. Welcome to the Found in the Wild segment. This is where we find things that from our fans and from people that are part of our communities that are not yet publicly out there. And we can see here that this first Found in the Wild is from, I'm not knowing what the name of the person is because it looks like we just scanned in on the screenshot of her, but she belongs to the Social Media Marketing Society. Maybe we have it somewhere in the notes. But what we're looking at here, Eric, why don't you describe what we're looking at here and I can try to figure out who this came from.
Yeah, so what we're looking at here is people are able to go to, in this test, she was able to go to her profile and she was able to kind of see, you know, her, it almost feels to me like a Facebook clout score for the week, where it gives you the amount of reactions and the friends and comments that she got this week. And she can kind of keep more of a, you know, almost an engagement analytics for how her personal account went for the week.
So this is from Kelly Mirabella. And it's kind of cool because this is kind of like little statistics, like Eric said, of like how active and reactive your friends have been on your posts. And editorial team, let's make a note to include the name of the person in here just in the future so I can properly do those call outs. Second thing is, let's go to the next one, Eric, another Found in the Wild. You want to go ahead and describe, wait a minute. Is this the next one? Multiple times and dates, Eric, did we miss that one?
Oh, no, that's right here. Sorry. There we go. So this one, you are now able to, well, I don't want to say you're now able to. Again, another scene in the wild, another test, is that Facebook is making it easier to schedule multiple times and dates for events. So if you have an event that it has multiple dates, multiple times, you will now, supposedly in the future, when they roll this out, be able to take advantage of that. This could be pretty cool for if you've got recurring, well, not recurring, but like if you've got multiple events in a way.
Yep, and I'm continuing to play the Found in the Wild music. I don't know if you guys can hear that, but that'll just remind us, hey, this is stuff we found in the wild. Okay, the next thing, Eric, let's go over to the Mari Smith post that I think might be a little out of order here. So this is pretty cool. This is Mari Smith finished her video, and guess what she found? She found an encouraging opportunity to see other videos that were not from Mari Smith. And that's kind of intriguing because that means there's going to be some incredible opportunity to have a discovery with live video. And this is kind of what I think we might see, for example, on YouTube or something. So this live video is ended and look what pops up. Three other live videos that you could pop right into and watch right there so that they'll keep you on Facebook. Now that, you know, what we don't know exactly is whether or not this only shows up for those that were watching live. Or whether it showed up because someone missed the live video. I mean, this is the part that we don't totally understand. From the marketer inside of me doesn't want this, right? Unless they're my own videos. I wouldn't want someone to go from my video directly to some other video. But the marketer in me also says, well, wait a second, Mike, if you're live, you could capture some new audience here. It's kind of small. I don't know how in the world you could even know what it's about. That's my only concern, right? It's like,
yeah,
she is showing some arrows down there on the bottom, but it's not obvious to me what the connection is between what we're seeing on the bottom there and what she has. I think that maybe those two are actually, I don't think she created this screenshot with the stuff on the bottom. It looks like they're actually maybe somehow connected. It's a little confusing to me. Do you understand what that is? I mean, I understand that she's drawing the arrows between the two, but it just seems kind of strange, like especially if I'm on a mobile device and I see these little tiny squares, I don't know what they are. I don't know how in the world I'm going to even click through to them, but it is intriguing nonetheless.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think the implementation is not quite there yet.
And Mari said, just like with mid-roll ads, you have zero control over what related videos are displayed and what ads are shown on your broadcast. So it sounds like this is the beginning of Facebook's, this could be the beginning of Facebook actually doing some exciting stuff where you could pay to have your video included with other videos. All right, Eric, we got to go into beast mode here. We got a lot more news, so let's keep going.
All right. Instagram has rolled out officially for all users the archive function. In this image, we're seeing a, if you want to archive something, you tap the three dots on that image up in the upper right, and then this menu comes up and you can tap archive. You can then, if you want to unarchive it, go to that same image in your archive and tap the three dots, and then you can click show on profile, and it'll put it back where it was.
Instagram is also making sponsored content more transparent with new tags. Recently, the FCC has come out with new rules, and CNN found that 93% of the top 50 Instagram celebrities are not properly letting the world know that they are sponsored posts. So Instagram has basically done what they do on Facebook, which is, and I don't know, it's kind of hard to read, but somewhere on there it says, what does it say, Eric? Can you read what it says underneath?
Yes. Up in the upper top underneath it says, underneath their username, it says paid partnership with Volvo Car USA.
Got it. And the key thing here is that just like with Facebook, when you tag this post as being a sponsored or paid post, the data is now shared with the sponsor. So that's kind of the exciting news here, right? So the creator normally gets metrics, and now the sponsor will get those exact metrics. But this is the way that Instagram is beginning to embrace the FCC regulations of disclosure. All right. Apple, we've got some news from Apple. Apple is rolling out a brand new analytics for podcasters. Do we have any podcasters here? We've been waiting forever for this. Apple soon will be allowing those of us that have podcasts, like Eric and I both do, to see Apple data. And what's exciting about this data, from what I've heard, is they're going to begin to tell you how long people are watching your podcast. That is the thing that nobody knows. All we know is the number of downloads. So they're going to show you which podcasts are the most popular, how long people are actually staying through the podcast. And this is going to be very, very exciting. There's not a lot on this other than we know it's coming from Apple. Over to you, Eric.
Facebook's Messenger M is now offering security in both English and Spanish. And that's pretty much the extent of it.
Okay. This next one is exciting. Do we have a screenshot on this? Google, there's some brand new object recognition technology coming from Google. And maybe you could scroll down just a little bit here. This is nuts, people. This new thing is called mobile nets, okay? And with mobile nets, it's basically an open source technology that you can employ into any app, and it could be used to analyze faces, detect common objects, geolocate photos, and perform fine-grained recognition tasks like identifying different species of dogs. So, you know, Pinterest has been doing a lot of this stuff, right, where you can look at something and know what it is and find other products like it. Well, Google's decided we're going to make this available as a tool for developers for any app. So this is going to be a really, really big deal. And it's brand new data and it's object recognition. So I think we could see a lot of our popular social networks potentially employing some of this technology. Over to you, Eric.
Facebook is giving the audience network advertising. Sorry, that's yours. Where is it? Facebook allows verified pages to promote a Facebook Live video during their broadcast. And this was courtesy of Dennis Yu from a partner memo. And basically, they're rolling out the ability for verified pages to promote a Facebook Live video during the broadcast. That means that you can be live and you can let even more people know you're live by promoting it while you're live.
Very cool. Facebook is, for the audience network, the audience network is Facebook's ability, it's like Google AdWords, where you can, or AdSense, if you will, I forget which one it is, AdWords. Google has a network where you can get ads on other people's websites. Well, Facebook does too. It's called the audience network. They now have a lot more ability for advertisers to decide where those ads go. Apple, we're just going to go really quick. Apple is also sharing more details on their business chat. Give us a quick 10 second on that, Eric.
So they're going to allow you, we pretty much covered this last week in as much as we had, and what they've done is that they've basically given up the ability to do a messenger chat like customer service option plugged into many of the different programs that they have in terms of ordering food and a lot of the different things like that.
The last thing is Snapchat, this is speculative, is reporting to be developing a second generation augmented reality version of spectacles, which I'm kind of excited about. So we'll see where that goes. All right, in the last 10 seconds, we just want to say thank you guys for coming. Don't forget to check out Social Media Marketing World, smmw18.com. Sale ends today. Awesome deal on tickets. We thank you guys for coming. Become a regular subscriber. Visit socialmediaexaminer.com/live show. And with that, goodbye Facebook, goodbye YouTube, goodbye Periscope. We'll talk to you guys later, and goodbye Crowdcast. Everybody have a wonderful day. Bye-bye.